Well, a very, very good morning to you all. It's lovely to be together this morning to worship the Lord, and a very warm welcome whether you're here for the first time or for the millionth time. It's wonderful to be together, and also a particular welcome to those watching online. Apologies that we haven't been able to offer a service online for the last couple of Sundays, but it's good to welcome you online again this morning. And before we begin our service of worship today, or as we begin, we have some banns of marriage to publish, which is a great privilege being part of the Church of England. And so I publish the banns of marriage between Robert William Kilvert of our parish here and Lauren Elizabeth Simmons, also of our parish here in St Mark, Southampton, and also between Richard John Neesham of our parish here, St Mark's, and Yolande Edith Buffon of St Anne Hoxton with St Columba. I think that's somewhere in London. So this is the second time of asking if any of you know any reason in law why these persons may not marry each other. You are to declare it now. Wonderful. Let's pray for these couples as they get ready for their married lives together. Father, thank you for Robert and Lauren, Richard and Yolande. Thank you for their love for each other. And thank you, Lord, that you are the God of love and the God of marriage. And we pray for them as they prepare for their big days and for their lives together. And we ask your blessing, your peace, Lord, upon them in Jesus' name. Amen. So before our worship band come to lead us in our sung worship, we begin with a prayer. God, our shepherd, you gather us into your kingdom and into your loving arms. You seek us out when we are lost. You rescue us when we are in trouble. You welcome us when we return home. Make us, your church, your people, into a sanctuary for all who are fearful, a place of healing for those who are broken, and a welcoming home for all who seek it. Amen. And would you join with me as we offer God our opening prayer? We pray together. Let us come before the God of our salvation, offering him all praise and glory. Let us join the angels standing around the throne as we offer ourselves in worship to God, saying, Amen. Praise and glory and wisdom and thanks and honor and power and strength be to our God forever and ever. Amen. I'm going to invite our worship band to come and lead us in song. Thank you.
Let's just take this moment to focus our attention on the Lord this morning. And if you feel comfortable, maybe you'd like to hold out your hands as a sign that you're ready to receive. Oh, Holy Spirit, would you fall in this place? Would you meet us in a new way this morning? Would you teach us something new about who you are? Because you are worthy of praise, Father. You're worthy of our praise. Yes, Jesus, you are our everything. Because of who you are and what you've done for us, you are worthy of all of our praise, Father. Jesus. You're worthy, Jesus. You're worthy. Thank you.
Thank you to our worship band. Please do be seated. So it's time for our children now to go to their group in the capable hands of Wendy and Vanessa. So let's pray for them as they spend some time together. Father, thank you for our precious children and young people, and we ask, Lord, that you would draw close to them as they meet today, as they learn more of you. Lord, be close to them as they grow up. Help them grow each day in a deeper knowledge of you. In Jesus' name, amen. So if parents and carers can take their children upstairs, that would be wonderful. Thank you. And as we continue in our worship, we turn our attention to confession. Just thinking about that phrase that we've just sung about incense arising day and night, night and day, incense arising to the Lord. And it just struck me how beautiful it is that our hearts turned towards the Lord in praise, in repentance, our worship of him, our song, is like incense to him. It's like a beautiful aroma. And it just struck me how lovely that is, and how what a blessing and a privilege it is to be able to turn our attention to the Lord and for him to receive that as such a beautiful thing, beautiful aroma, like incense arising. And the fact that we can do that day and night, night and day. And we have a particular opportunity every Sunday to come before the Lord in confession and to bring ourselves honestly before him and say sorry to him and to receive his refreshing, cleansing, empowering. And that's what we do this morning as we confess. But just a reminder that that's like a beautiful aroma to the Lord. God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Let us then show our love for him by confessing our sins in penitence and faith. We pray together. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry. Repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. May Almighty God have mercy on you, forgive you your sins, and bring you to everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And would you join with me as we pray the special prayer for today? Risen Christ, faithful shepherd of your Father's sheep, teach us to hear your voice and to follow your command, that all people may be gathered into one flock, to the glory of God the Father. Amen. And now we're going to have our Bible readings brought to us by Liz and Lizzie. Thank you.
The first reading is Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want. He makes me lie down in green pastures, and he leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. This is the word of the Lord.
Our second reading is John chapter 10, verses 22 to 30. Then came the festival of dedication at Jerusalem. It was winter, and Jesus was in the temple courts walking in Solomon's colonnade. The Jews who were there gathered round him, saying, "How long will you keep us in suspense? If you are the Messiah, tell us plainly." Jesus answered, "I did tell you, but you do not believe. The works I do in my Father's name testify about me, but you do not believe because you are not my sheep. My sheep listen to my voice. I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all. No one can snatch them out of my Father's hand. I and the Father are one." This is the word of the Lord.
Morning, lovely people. Right. Part of our journey, isn't it, realising that we're all lovely people. Don't always feel like it. Just a quick prayer. Lord, please help us to see you more clearly. Amen. God is so huge, isn't he? He's so absolutely massive, and there's lots of people, trains of thought, that would say he's really not knowable. He's just so far above us, so almighty, so different, so spiritual, that really we can't know him at all. And this passage, this John 10 passage that we're going to look at, and I'm going to follow it a little bit more closely than usual, sort of we'll work through it together a bit. Want to say differently to that we can know God, we can know what God is like. So that's what this is all about, is what is God like, what is Jesus like. We're constantly getting more information, perhaps, about God. If we've been following him for a while, then maybe we're constantly readjusting the way that we perceive God. And the other morning, I was in a little prayer group. Lizzie was there, and when she brought this 1 minute meditation, and it said, it asked the question, "Do you smile when you think of God?" And I sat there and I thought, I don't think I do. I really don't think, no, that isn't the first thing I think of when I think of God. And I thought, well, that's a bit sad, really, because my Heavenly Father loves me, and maybe I should just lighten up a little bit, you know. Maybe it would be a bit more fun for him if I smiled in his presence, if I really just enjoyed him a bit more. So let's explore a bit. What we're going to do is we're going to take a walk through the passage, and then I'll say this now so you've got time to think, okay? I'm going to come around with a roving mic, and I'm going to ask you for one word descriptions of God. The first thing that comes to your mind when you think about God, and probably something that means something to you, maybe it's the starting point that you often have when you consciously enter his presence. And then just a brief thought, well, what do we do with this information? Now we've understood something more about him, where do I go with that? So let's just start walking through the passage a little bit. And it starts, it says, Jesus was in the temple during a Jewish winter festival. Now, I looked this up because I thought, is that just a bit of padding? Does it really matter where he was, you know, when he said these things? And so I was curious about that. And it turns out that the festival that he was at was something called Hanukkah. And if you're like me, you probably, well, maybe you do know what the Jewish festivals are. I'd never come across that one. So I thought, oh, I'll just look it up in case it's relevant. And what they were doing was every year they celebrated the Maccabean liberation of Jerusalem, which took place about 200 years ago from the time of Jesus, when initially a guerrilla army liberated Jerusalem from the Greek Seleucids. And it was a bit of a surprising victory. They started off as a bit of a ragtag bunch of fighters, and they eventually got an army together, and they actually got their freedom back. And it was quite short-lived, because soon after that, the Romans came and got them. And so they were back being occupied again. So there they were, celebrating their national freedom, which they'd lost some time ago. And they'd been noticing Jesus doing all these amazing things. So they say, tell us plainly, are you the Messiah? Meaning, are you going to be our new leader who's going to regain our national independence for us? Are you going to be the one that leads us into booting the Romans out of Jerusalem? And Jesus, somewhat frustratingly, says, I've told you this. Yes, I am, but you don't believe me. Why? Then, why wouldn't they hear his voice? Why couldn't they understand him? And it seems to me that the reason was he wasn't saying what they wanted him to say. And maybe that's something we could all learn from. You know, sometimes we just want Jesus to tell us what we want to hear, and Jesus might be bringing something else. At the beginning of Jesus' ministry, he said, I've come to... He's quoting from Isaiah 61. He says, I've come to set the captives free. And if there was anybody that ever felt captive, it's probably the Jewish people. Was he talking about liberating them from the Romans at that point? Or was it something completely different? So, this thing about recognizing Jesus' voice... For some people, you hear Jesus' voice, maybe from the Gospels, or somebody says something, or you read something, and you think, yeah, that's it. It resonates in here. And that's straightforward enough. And I would say, if you got that sense, maybe if you read the Gospels and you hear Jesus speaking, you say, yeah, that's it. Listen to that, because that is him talking to you. Respond to that. But if not, and a lot of people don't get that, then maybe it's time to rethink what understanding we have of who Jesus is. Is the Jesus that you're perceiving, is that a fair representation? Or was that something that was said to you many, many years ago by whoever? By a parent, a guardian, a teacher? Is it time to reassess who he is? Because the fact is, Jesus wasn't interested in fighting the Romans. He had a much bigger global enemy in his sights. And that enemy basically is death. Jesus came to fight death and the evil powers and to do something. And this is where mystery comes in. What really happened on the cross when Jesus died and rose again? It is a mystery. There's lots and lots of figurative language in the Bible about that, which seeks to explain it. I don't think we'll ever fully understand it. But one thing that he did do on the cross was he defeated death and its powers so that we can rise again. He claimed to be the resurrection and the life. Isn't that an amazing thing? these days we don't really think in those terms very much. We don't think in terms of fighting the evil powers so much. Maybe that's our denomination. Other groups may focus on that more. But we don't want to lose that emphasis. And if there's any doubt about what Jesus thought he was doing, we only have to look to the next chapter, John chapter 11, which is actually where he says about being the resurrection and the life, because that is the chapter where Lazarus has died and Jesus demonstrates his power over death by raising Lazarus back to life again. He wants us to know that's the power that he has to bring us back to life. Sometimes we can feel pretty dead, can't we? I don't know about you. I feel pretty dead inside sometimes. And I look to Jesus to somehow get the energy back in me, you know, particularly if I have been wandering off and doing stuff that maybe isn't conducive with a spiritual life, you know. The power goes, the energy goes. We need him to reinflate us with his spirit, don't we? So Jesus is interested in the cosmic battle between good and evil. There's loads of films that focus on that theme, aren't there? Those are really good films, actually. They're not meant to be spiritual films or Christian films, but that ongoing theme of the battle between good and evil is as much in the forefront of the minds of our society now as it ever has been, and it's played out on the cinema screens all the time. So Jesus gives his followers eternal life and says they will never perish and they can't be snatched away. The Father is, this is verses 28 and 29, the Father has given Jesus a gift which is greater than all else, and that can't be snatched away. And then he underlines it and he says this amazing claim about who he is: the Father and I are one. Now that is really extreme, isn't it? You can't get more extreme than that. And is it the only time that kind of statement is made in the Bible? Is that just a one-off thing which you can more or less forget because it's just the only time it's said, you know? Well, I thought I'd better check. So quite a few of these sayings are in John. John 12:45, whoever sees me sees the one who sent me. John 14:9, Jesus says to Philip, anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. Anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. Paul says in Colossians 1 verse 15, the Son is the image of the invisible God. The same idea. If you want to know what God is like, take a look at Jesus. He is a depiction of the character and the nature of God. If you read the Gospels and see the things that Jesus says and does and the power that he has, it is an expression of God. And then in Hebrews, this is a great verse, this one. Hebrews 1:3. The Son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his nature. Jesus is the exact representation in human form of the nature of God. So the Jewish people who are not believing him when he's saying these kind of things accuse him of blasphemy. And they pick up stones to stone him because they actually do realise the full gravity of what he's saying, and they don't like it. Jesus says to them, for which of these good works, meaning his miracles, his healings, bringing sight back to the blind, that sort of thing, are you stoning me? And they say, it's not because of your good works, it's because as a human, you are making yourself God. So a bit of an argument ensues at this point. And these are the kind of arguments that are common today. And when Christians talk about the divinity of Jesus, they refer to Scripture quite often to say the kind of things I've just been saying now. And of course, in Jesus' time, they had the Old Testament Scriptures. The Psalms were read and sung all the time. And he appeals to Psalm 82, verse 6. which refers to a verse that calls us humans gods with a small g. And he makes an argument based on that, based on the scripture, that actually he's not being blasphemous. They're not impressed. Doesn't get anywhere with them. So then he says, well, look, if you won't sort of look at the scriptures, because there's a lot more scriptures to talk about who Jesus is. It's not just that one. There's lots of prophecies about him coming and that sort of thing. He says, if you can't believe because of the scriptures, then how about believing because of the miracles that you've seen? Aren't they a proof? He says, if I'm not doing Father's work, then don't believe me. But if I do the Father's works, then believe the works, so that you may understand that, another phrase coming up, I am in the Father, and the Father is in me. Now, he's deliberately done that, the I am bit at the beginning of that phrase. It's a play on words, really. Because in Exodus 3, verse 14, God said to Moses, I am who I am. This is what you are to say to the Israelites. I am, he's using I am as a name, has sent me to you. Jesus is saying, I am the Son of God. God the Father has sent me to you. The Jews are very upset now. So they try to arrest him, and he escapes. And because of the heat that's been generated, Jesus then has to retreat across the Jordan River to where John had been baptizing, and it says that many believed in him because they could see that what John foretold of Jesus was true because of the signs, because of the miracles that Jesus performed. Sorry. So there we are. Jesus' claim for divinity. He says he's done all these amazing things, and he's seeking, I guess, our response. What do you think? Do you believe me? Are you of my sheep? So, here's the bit where we get the Ravi mic out. I don't know whether you've been thinking of any names that you feel particularly describe God, what the character of God, the nature of God, what he means to you. You can Google anything these days, can't you? So I've got here, I put in one single words that describe the nature of God. Look at that lot. Some are better than others. He is huge, isn't he? God is big. There's so many ways of describing him, so many ways of describing Jesus, so many different experiences of Jesus. It can appear sometimes that faith is such a narrow thing. You know, Jesus is the way, the only way. Yet Jesus is so broad, he's so big. Everybody experiences God differently. Not any of us in this room have the same perception, the same idea of who Jesus is. So when people accuse people of faith as being so narrow, it's the other way around, actually. God is expansive, isn't he? He's absolutely the biggest and the best thing. There is freedom in Jesus. So we all have a particular way, particular thought. And who wants to go first? Who wants to come up with that?
A very quick word. Okay, so I didn't know God as Father and friend. I can say God is Father and friend now. And when we had times of worship like that, I'd feel really bored, if I'm honest, and I'd think, I can't relate. I don't know what all the fuss is, you know, that God is everything and he sits on the throne and we worship him. And for years, that part of my church and spiritual life has been dead and I've been bored. But what's happened lately, I don't know how it's happened. I've just trusted God at his word. So he often gives me little images or little pictures or little dreams, or as I'm talking to somebody, a little understandings. And what's happened over the years is I'm running with that now. I'm trusting that that is God, instead of thinking, oh, it's just coincidence. And I see that in this world, like, Satan wants to snatch away anything that's good that's passed on to us, any little word, any encouragement, anything of himself, anything that can help or bless somebody else. As soon as it comes into our mind, it's like a little seed, and Satan would love to snatch it away and say, it's just a coincidence. There's not really a God who loves you. So I've tuned out that voice now. I don't listen to that voice now, and I'm running with God. And now I know him as Father, and now I know him as friend, and I can really enjoy that kind of worship now. And I've taken more than my minute. Thank you.
I did think with that first song, I didn't bother with the sermon really, because it was absolutely fantastic.
I'm a bit like Denise in that I've got three things to say. The first one is really exciting this morning. That I think that God knows us, and he knows us really well. I get really frustrated with Will. The kids can tell you that I've thrown handbags at him and all sorts of things when I've got really frustrated rather than... And this morning he made me frustrated again. I was going down the stairs to turn the alarm off. I got down to the bottom of the stairs, I was just turning it off, and I was going, God, why did you give me such a frustrating man to be my husband? And I was... And so I was walking through the kitchen, and this doesn't happen very often to me, but very, very, all of a sudden as I got there, this voice said to me, because I knew he would love you. And that was what I needed to hear. So that was just so, you know, frustrating, but he loves me. And the other two things are these two pictures. I don't know if I've shown them to you before, but. Right, so this one is my chickens. And not that God is like a chicken, but for me, that's me, under there, being looked after and cared for. So God is someone who I can take refuge in, and he cares for me, and that's really great. And when my dad had cancer, I drew that picture for him just before he died, because he came to know Jesus through my wonderful daughter here, and it really brought him comfort to see that. It really did. And this picture is hands being held, and that was, if I hadn't have had this while I was going through all that I was going through with Dad, this was that God was guiding me, supporting me, and that he was always there. And, you know, Lizzie, who prays with me a lot, knows all about this, because this verse was a verse that she gave me, unbeknownst to the fact that God had already given it to me as well. So it's, for I, the Lord your God, will hold your right hand, saying to you, fear not, I will help you. And he really does. If I couldn't have got through it, if I hadn't have known God as a supporter and a friend and a refuge.
Thank you. Lots of one-word things there. Supporter, friend, refuge, comforter.
For me, God is loving and forgiving.
Yeah, forgiving, absolutely. Someone said that about a third of what Jesus is reported to have said in the Gospels is to do with forgiveness, apparently.
Mine is short and sweet, which is, I think, knowing God is an adventure.
Do you want to say why you? No? Okay, fine. An adventure. Anything? Oh, yeah.
My word of the moment is God as observer. We say all seeing. And I'm going to be nerdy because I've struggled recently, intellectually, with quantum mechanics, which take away causation and consciousness, but God being observer is the resolution of Schrodinger's cat dilemma. Everything collapses when somebody's watching, and God is always watching everything. That's for the nerds in you, all right? Okay.
Well, we won't blame you for being confused about quantum mechanics anyway. That's, okay. Peter.
Just a few words I felt God said to me through my dad's voice. The day he was diagnosed with terminal cancer, and he said to me, I love you ever so much. And I really felt God was saying to me exactly the same words as straying, child, and it brought me back to God in a way I'd never known before.
Thanks, Peter. Yeah, often we feel negative words have been said that we hang on to, but the other way around, though, is that positive words are said and they're more powerful. Yeah, thank you, Peter. Yeah. Sorry, who was...
So on a different note, I think that God has a really good sense of humour. And I was explaining this to Derek. I was trying to think of a verse that illustrated this really well. So I prayed as I was walking down. I can't think of a really good example of this. And I got Matthew 5, verse 9. So I looked it up when I got here, full of hope that it would be a really good verse about Jesus being really humorous. And it was, "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they are the children of God." So anyway, I think that kind of illustrates his point. So.
Thank you. Liz.
I think he's a trendsetter. And what I mean by that is I was just thinking about how meditation has become such a big thing in the last few years. And actually Jesus modelled meditation long, long before then. And it's something that we've been doing long before it became, you know, a thing to do.
Fantastic. Yeah. Lizzie.
I love the fact that God welcomes us, no matter who we are, no matter what we've done. If we turn to him, he is just so excited to welcome us into his presence.
Yeah. Completely welcoming and inclusive, yeah.
Hiya. I was just thinking about that children's chorus, but it's just so profound because it picks up what you were saying at the beginning of your talk and also what I think was in either the songs or the reading. Our God is a great big God. Our God is a great big God. Our God is a great big God. And he holds us in his hands.
He holds us, yes. Anyone else? Oh, Will, yeah, wants to retaliate?
No, it's not a response, honest. God is graceful and full of compassion. Because... if he wasn't, none of the other stuff would be available to us. And his gift of salvation would be denied us.
Okay, thank you all so much for... Oh, right, okay.
Accessible.
Very disciplined, that was. Thank you, Annie. Did you want to say anything? Yeah, okay. Okay, so what do we do with this information? You know, I guess the time is way gone, is it? I don't know. Yeah. In the first half of John chapter 10, Jesus has a describing word for... I don't need this, what am I doing? For himself. Which is that he says that he is the good shepherd and that he is the gate. And he repeats this thing about being the gate. He's the gate to safety from those who would devour the sheep. Sometimes we could think of the gate as something that locks us in, but it isn't. It's something that provides access to safety. And actually Jesus says that the sheep come and they go. It isn't something that locks us in, it's something that brings security and the freedom to explore, the freedom to find the pasture. And Jesus says that he lays his life down for the sheep to take it up again. And so Jesus' death on the cross wasn't the end, it was actually the thing that broke the power of death. We're not living in the full reality of that yet. But he did, this is what the scriptures tell us, he broke the power of death when he died on the cross and he returned full of life to bring that life to us. That life is available to us, we experience it in all these different ways. So I just thought we could just finish with a brief prayer and just present ourselves to God and ask for more of him. So here we go. Father, we thank you that you're a God who reveals himself. You revealed yourself through Jesus, and you are the Good Shepherd. Jesus is the Good Shepherd who offers us so much, and we want to present ourselves to you and ask for more. And if we haven't done that consciously yet, then maybe we can do it now. And for those of us who have been following you for a while, we want to follow you better. We want to understand you more, and we want to know where you're leading us. And we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Derek, so much for that. That was absolutely wonderful. And yes, the time is completely gone, but there was no way that I wanted to stop us giving such a wonderful testimony and sharing with one another who the Lord is to us, because it's just so encouraging and life-giving, isn't it, just to hear from one another in that way. For me, my thing ties in with what Helen was saying about God being, life with God being an adventure. I think God calls us to things that are so much bigger than us, so much bigger than what we have capacity for. And he lets us join in with that adventure because he's got all the answers. He knows the way. He's got the provision. But he lets us go on that adventure with him as he calls us to great things. So that's that would be my little contribution to it. So I'm going to slightly rearrange the order of things as we go forward. And I think the next thing is the song that we're going to sing, Psalm 23 now. So let's stand and worship the Lord and bring all of those thoughts and worship of our hearts to the Lord as we sing together. I invite you to stand.
So this version of this song might be new to you, but just join in when you're able.
The Lord is my shepherd. He goes before me. Defender behind me. I won't fear. I'm filled with anointing. My cup's overflowing. Thank you.
The Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. You are worthy of our thanks and praise, Lord God of truth, for by the breath of your mouth you have spoken your word, and all things have come into being. You fashioned us in your image and placed us in the garden of your delight. Though we chose the path of rebellion, you would not abandon your own. Again and again you drew us into your covenant of grace. You gave your people the law and taught us by your prophets to look for your reign of justice, mercy, and peace. As we watch for the signs of your kingdom on earth, we echo the song of the angels in heaven, evermore praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Please do be seated. Lord God, you are the most holy one, enthroned in splendor and light. Yet in the coming of your Son, Jesus Christ, you reveal the power of your love, made perfect in our human weakness. Amen. Lord, we believe. Embracing our humanity, Jesus showed us the way of salvation. Loving us to the end, he gave himself to death for us. Dying for his own, he set us free from the bonds of sin that we might rise and reign with him in glory. Amen. Lord, we believe. On the night he gave himself up for us all, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Amen. Lord, we believe. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Amen. Lord, we believe. Therefore, we proclaim the death that he suffered on the cross. We celebrate his resurrection, his bursting from the tomb. We rejoice that he reigns at your right hand on high, and we long for his coming in glory. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. As we recall the one perfect sacrifice of our redemption, Father, by your Holy Spirit, let these gifts of your creation be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Form us into the likeness of Christ and make us a perfect offering in your sight. Amen. Come, Holy Spirit. Look with favor on your people and in your mercy hear the cry of our hearts. Bless the earth. Heal the sick, let the oppressed go free, and fill your church with power from on high. Amen. Come, Holy Spirit. Gather your people from the ends of the earth to feast with all your saints at the table in your kingdom, where the new creation is brought to perfection in Jesus Christ our Lord. By whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Amen. And as Jesus our Savior taught us, so we pray together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body because we all share in one bread. We welcome all those baptized who know and love the Lord Jesus to come and receive from his table this morning. And if you're not sure of if you would prefer a prayer of blessing, please just hold your hands down at your sides to indicate to me. But otherwise, if you hold your hand, hold your hands out in a cupped way like that, and I'll place the wafer dipped in wine in your hands. If you would like prayer, to receive prayer this morning, please do make your way into the side hall and our prayer team will be ready and waiting to pray for you. So draw near with faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
At the cross, at the
join together in praying the prayer after communion. Merciful Father, you gave your Son Jesus Christ to be the Good Shepherd, and his love in his love for us to lay down his life and rise again. Keep us always under his protection and give us grace to follow in his steps through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now, I have a few pieces of church family news to let you know about. Before I do that, I would like to say it's so lovely to see Yolande and Richard here with us this morning, whose bands we published right at the start of the service. So you missed the official bit, but if you'd be happy, we would love for you to stand and can we pray for you? Is that all right? Thank you so much. It's lovely to have you with us this morning. So actually, Alison, would you stand as well? Because you can stand representing Robert and Lauren, can't you, as well? So Father, thank you so much for these precious couples, Yolande and Richard and Robert and Lauren. And Lord, we pray your rich and abundant blessings upon them as they draw close to the time of their special day. And Lord, thank you that you are in their relationships, Lord. You're right there in the heart of them. And Lord, we ask that you would bind them together. And Lord, keep them in your peace as they, in the busyness of all the preparations. But Lord, may your blessing, your rich and abundant blessing, rest upon all of them. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. So a few bits of church family news to let you know about. Thank you so much to those of you who have offered to help with the school SAT tests. We've got a member of St Mark's staff with us this morning, which is great, Maggie. It's lovely to have you with us today. Thank you for those who have volunteered. It really makes a big difference to the school, and they're very, very grateful for our help. That's this week coming, but actually next week, we have another request for help, which is fantastic to have the opportunity to be involved. The school want to trial closing Stafford Road just to help with the sort of parking situation and the residents there. They want to have volunteers to help just at the beginning of the day and at the end of the school day to help staff the road closing part. Training's going to be offered. They need help between 8:15 a.m. and 8:45, and 2:40 and 3:20. So if any of us can offer help any of the days of that week at any of those times, please will you let me or Jane in the office know. It's going to involve just standing on the road, letting residents out, and probably explaining to people as well about the road closures. But as I say, full training will be given. So if you can help with that, that would be fantastic. Also, Helen, did you want to come and talk about, where are you, Helen? Come and talk about the community fete that's coming up. We're very excited about that on the 28th of May. Looking forward to that. We haven't been able to do that for a couple of years, so we're really delighted.
Yes, thank you. So we've got our community fete on the 28th of May, which is 2 weeks on Saturday between 12 and 3. So it's going to be a barbecue and afternoon teas and stalls and games and all the usual stuff. But we really need your help. There's a few of us organising it, but we need your help. We can't do it on our own. The aim is for us to have fun, but also for the community. And the one we had a few years ago, loads and loads of people came. So really hoping people are going to come. We've got the poster up today. I think we're going to be doing leaflets and invite the schools and things and social media. So we could have lots and lots of people. But we really need your help. So if you can help on the day, I think we're going to start setting up at, I'm looking at Dick and Jen, about 9 o'clock on the day. People come and help us. Also, if you have any ideas of things you want to do, some stalls, come and talk to either Jen, Kez, Dick or myself. That'd be great. But we really need help on the day. And we will need help with cakes and scones. I'm looking at the others. Do we need cakes? Yeah, cakes. Yeah. We always like cakes in this church. Cakes, yeah, we all would like our cakes because we do teas and coffees. We don't charge. We want lots of really lovely, scrummy cakes. So, yeah, help on the day, the 28th, please. But ideas, come to talk to one of us. Thank you.
Brilliant. Thanks, Helen, very much. That's great. There's a couple of other things. In a little while, actually, I think Andrew's probably put this leaflet here. Do you remember the litter picks that we've done in the past, been involved with in the Bannister area just on our doorstep? There's one happening today at 2:30 p.m. Meet on the junction of Westrow Road and Archers Road. All the equipment is provided, so if you can get involved with that, I know it's a bit short notice, but you might just happen to have a free afternoon and like to go, and it makes a real difference to the community to clear up the rubbish, so thank you. Also, the lovely flowers today are for Tracy's mum, Margaret, so thank you to Wendy for those. And just finally, but last but not least, our Connect groups, which we're very excited about starting in the next couple of weeks. Thank you so much to those of you who've signed up. For those of you who don't know, these are groups that are meeting fortnightly for this term, and it's all about getting to know one another, just getting to know folks in the church who perhaps you don't know so well. That's the whole aim of them. And also having a chance to fellowship with one another as well. And it's not too late. If you haven't signed up yet and you'd like to, please, please let either me or Jane in the office know, because we would love everyone, as many people as possible who see themselves as part of St Mark's or would like to be part of St Mark's, to be involved with those Connect groups. So I think that's all I need to say. So let's go to our final song, which is Lord Jesus, We Enthrone You. It's a good song to end on, isn't it? Would you like to?
Jesus, we enthrone you. We proclaim.
Pray together. Lord Jesus Christ, you humbled yourself in taking the form of a servant, and in obedience died on the cross for our salvation. Give us the courage to follow you and to proclaim you as Lord and King, to the glory of God the Father. Amen. God the Father, who has given to his Son the name above every name, strengthen you to proclaim Christ as Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, rest upon you now and always. Amen.